Yeah, my name is John Fox. I'm the president of the Federal Society. I wanted to thank Business Law Society and Intellectual Property Association for co-sponsoring this event with us. Today we have two speakers. We have Professor Mark Janis, who's a professor here at the law school. We also have Professor Ryan Holte, who's an assistant professor at Southern Illinois University School of Law. We'll start with just introduction. So Mark Janis, he teaches courses in patents, trademarks, and other areas of intellectual property law. He's the Robert Lucas Chair of Law and the director of the Center for Intellectual Property Research. He has published numerous law review articles and book chapters on patent law, intellectual property, antitrust, trademark law, intellectual property protections for plants, plant biotechnology, and intellectual property protection for designs. Prior to joining the faculty at Indiana, Professor Janis was the H. Blair and Joan White Chair in Intellectual Property Law at University of Iowa College of Law. He practiced patent law at Barnes and Thornburg in Indianapolis for 6 years. For a keynote speaker, Ryan Holte, his teaching experience, his teaching expertise and scholarship interests include IP law and property law. He's a widely published author in IP subjects. His most recent articles focus on patent-related topics with a particular focus on patent trolls, equitable remedies in patent litigation, and empirical legal studies. He's a recipient of the two non-resident Thomas Edison Innovation Fellowships from George Mason University School of Law. To support his research on writing, research and writing on IP topics. His current works in progress include three empirical studies of patent litigation subjects. At the school, at SIU, Professor Holte teaches property law and intellectual property survey, and patent law. He also serves on the faculty IP committee and the IP alumni board as well. And with that, we'll let Professor Holte start with his speech. Yep. Thank you.
I may wander around. Can everybody hear me if I don't have the microphone on? Great. So thank you very much for hosting me. Thank you to the Federal Society for organizing this and for inviting me. And thank you very much to Professor Janis for participating. As was mentioned in the introduction, the focus of my scholarship focuses on patent trolls, and I think when it comes to intellectual property subjects and patent subjects in particular, patent trolls are probably the hottest thing discussed in the media today. So about a year and a half ago, I had the glowing opportunity to finally get that phone call that every law professor loves when they start from their mom, when they finally hear that the work that they're doing has some importance. And that was mainly because my mom saw patent trolls discussed on late-night TV. So it's rare for the patent troll or any patent discussion to make it to a late-night TV discussion, but we had that opportunity when John Oliver discussed what is a patent troll and spent about 17 minutes breaking down the problems associated with patent trolls. And part of that discussion is what really motivated me to get into a big part of what my current research is related to debunking some of these myths associated with patent trolls. So just to begin with, so that we can kind of all be on the same page about what a patent troll is, and I'm not very fond of what that term has come to mean, let's just get to a definition. So a patent troll is a person or company who enforces patent rights against accused infringers in an attempt to collect licensing fees. And here's the hook at what really makes them a troll: but does not manufacture products or supply services based upon the patents. So all they do is enforce patent rights. Well, that sounds bad. And they're also known by a couple other names that are less pejorative: non-practicing entities, patent assertion entities, patent middlemen, or patent aggregators. But what makes them a troll? Well, we have a nice little picture here. The idea is that you have a commercializing firm, that's the nice guy kind of looking dopey crossing the bridge. The commercializing firm is attempting to cross the bridge of innovation, but the patent troll is requiring a toll. So they're lurking under the bridge of innovation and just requiring a fee to be paid in order for that commercializing firm to actually do something. And the problem that's been associated with patent trolls is that they don't produce any products, but instead they're sending cease and desist letters in order to prevent commercializing firms from actually practicing their technology. They send demand letters that are incorrectly sent or just baseless as far as the accusations of litigation. Is that if they end up in litigation, they take advantage of the litigation process and they just try to extract a nuisance settlement from a large number of defendants. And then finally is that they're actually suing end users. And more specifically, there are a couple, you know, fundamental accusations that have been brought against them. And a couple that I'd like to point out to is first off, is that they're not innovating themselves. They seek to acquire broad patent claims and that encompass existing technologies, and then they sue on them. And then finally, second from the bottom here, is that they're not transferring earned profits to inventors. So again, they're just a holdup on the patent system. And beyond late night TV, the troll problem has gotten so big that we've actually had patents discussed at a State of the Union address. So I think it was 2014 or 2015, President Obama actually spent a couple minutes of time discussing problems with the patent system. And it was kind of an interesting discussion amongst patent professors. We thought this was the first time that a president had mentioned patents in a State of the Union address, but it turns out it was the second time. It turns out George Washington actually discussed patents at his first State of the Union address, but he only told Congress that we need to get a patent act. We need to have Congress pass a bill on it. So he wasn't complaining about patent trolls then. But for about 200 years, we didn't have any discussion of patents from the president until now. And then the White House has actually made a big deal about this. We have a binder of innovation problems associated with patent trolls. The Federal Trade Commission, my old employer before entering academia, has done a number of reports and just came out with a large report recently in the last month regarding problems associated with patent trolls. And there's been a lot of proposals to fix this problem. So this guy on the right, Republican Congressman Bob Goodlatte from Virginia, has proposed the Innovation Act bill, and he's proposed it once. It passed the House, and I believe it kind of got hung up in the Senate back in 2013, 2014. And now it was reintroduced during the current Congress in February of 2015, and there's eight other pending bills in order to address this patent troll problem. And some of the fixes for this patent troll problem are disclosure requirements for entities that are actually levying litigation against companies, so they have to disclose certain things about who their investors are and how they acquired the patents that they own, specific case management rules, rules regarding the demand letters, cases against customers to be stayed, and then basically increased lawsuit filing requirements. And what's really unique about this is for no other type of civil litigation do we have these types of penalties across the board for all subject matters, except to be now proposed against patents. I mean, that's how bad the problem actually is. And there's other types of IP proposals that have been brought up as well, but fundamentally the patent context is what seems to be capturing Congress's ears. So what my research focuses on and the basis for my talk today is a detailed study of two patent trolls, so some of the worst patent trolls that we have seen discussed in the media and throughout litigation, and then to determine whether a number of these accusations actually stand up against them. So the first study was on the company Merck Exchange, which if you've taken intellectual property survey or patent law or potentially any civil remedies class, you're probably familiar with the Merck Exchange v. eBay case, which was a 2006 case that went to the United States Supreme Court, and the decision is now probably the fundamental decision for any civil injunction. Well, when Merck Exchange and eBay went up to the Supreme Court, they'd already had a number of years of patent litigation and civil litigation before them. But as they went to the Supreme Court, they were regarded as one of the worst examples of patent trolls. And a number of amicus briefs discussed this. eBay's brief definitely discussed this. It came up at oral argument and also became part of the decision in Justice Kennedy's separate concurrence. But the history of Merck Exchange is actually really interesting and was something that I spent about a year and a half studying, both in the litigation papers as well as with the founder and inventor. So in short, for a couple minutes, I will tell you about Merck Exchange, and then we'll talk about capital security systems. So the history of Merck Exchange goes back to the mid-1980s when the founder, a guy named Tom Woolston, was working as an engineer for the Central Intelligence Agency and was one of the first electrical engineers to begin work with a communication system that became the Internet. And Tom Woolston was a very smart guy, a very technical guy, and in the late 80s, early 90s, he transferred out of the CIA into private practice, and what he was passionate most about was baseball cards. And as he was sitting in his car in Northern Virginia one day, he was listening to a news report on the radio discussing all of these baseball cards and how much they were selling on the West Coast. And he was a Baltimore Orioles fan, and he really enjoyed collecting Orioles baseball cards, but he had this giant stack of baseball cards associated with teams on the West Coast that meant nothing to him, but he couldn't give them away on the East Coast. So he thought to himself, well, how is it that I can sell these baseball cards to people on the West Coast without flying myself to the West Coast? So knowing the basics for the Internet, he devised a complex computer system in order to transact with other people across the country and build a reputation. And his system worked pretty well. It was very complex. He and a couple other computer engineers developed it over a number of months, and he began to commercialize it and to attempt to build it within the growing Internet system in the mid-1990s. Unfortunately for Woolston, and we'll see this trend, is that he was not a very good businessman. He filed for patent protection for the process, and he thought that getting the patent over the sales network for this baseball card idea would be something that would cover it for himself and then also allow him to raise capital. That was not the case. He tried to partner with a number of online websites. He tried to partner with Auto Trader for selling cars and other things, and he was essentially just a bad businessman. Well, years go by. The eBay system grew as an online auction system based off feedback. And what's interesting about this story is that a lot of people think that eBay, once it started, immediately infringed Woolston's patent, but that's not the case. eBay was an online auction system that worked off a couple different ways that did not infringe Woolston's patent. It was not until the late 1990s when eBay was involved in a lawsuit against a company called Bidder's Edge related to online selling that Woolston noted that there were a couple other entities that eBay was suing that likely would have infringed his patent, and he approached eBay about interest in licensing that patent in order to assist them with the litigation against Bidder's Edge and others. Well, eBay looked at that, and they knew that their litigation with Bidder's Edge was ending, but they said, these Woolston patents are very interesting. Let's take a look at them. So they proposed with Woolston an opportunity to spend a couple months just exchanging documents and to see what Woolston had, to see how much his business was worth. And their idea here was that they would make an offer to Woolston to purchase his company and to purchase his patents at the end of it. Well, as time went on and a couple months went on, it became clear to Woolston and his company that eBay was not actually interested in buying his patents. eBay was more interested in stealing his patents. Negotiations broke down. eBay went silent. And about a month after that, eBay came out with a system on their website called Buy It Now that used some complex algorithms and communications associated with the direct purchase of things with a communication network intended to build feedback. And that was a direct infringement of Woolston's patents. Woolston subsequently filed a lawsuit against eBay, and that's where we end up with the well-known Merck Exchange v. eBay lawsuit. Long story short, on the end of that lawsuit, it ended up going to the district court. eBay was found to be, well, first, the Woolston patents were found to be valid, and they were found to be infringed by eBay. They were found to be willfully infringed by eBay, and the jury agreed that eBay did snooker Woolston and his company into disclosing all of this information and awarded Woolston and Merck Exchange over $30 million associated with the infringement that had occurred, plus ongoing infringement. Unfortunately for Woolston, the district court judge was decidedly anti-patent, denied an injunction. Woolston appealed to the Federal Circuit. The Federal Circuit reversed that decision in, unfortunately, a very short opinion that was then appealed to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court came up with the eBay Merck Exchange opinion that we all know, and then things were remanded back to the district court. Happy news at the end of the day was that Merck Exchange ended up finally settling with eBay for a very substantial sum, and Woolston is not a poor individual. eBay now owns those patents from Merck Exchange and has actually enforced them against others. Capital Security Systems, another company, not involved in any active litigation that you may know, but Capital Security Systems partnered with an individual named Eric Spangenberg, who is probably most known as the number one patent troll attorney. And if you've ever read any New York Times articles about patent trolls and you've seen a picture of a guy in a black turtleneck who's always frowning, that's Eric Spangenberg. He is a very wealthy litigation investor, an attorney, practiced with my old law firm, Jones Day in Cleveland, before going out on his own and representing companies. Capital Security Systems is one of the companies that he represented. The story of Capital Security Systems dates back also to the late 80s, early 1990s, and a lady named Robin Gustin, who had expertise in manufacturing processes. Her expertise related to kind of assembly line work in the paper system. She was friends with somebody in Arizona who was kind of in the payday loan area and was lamenting to her about the problems associated with check cashing and how much delay there was with banks approving it. Robin, knowing industrial processes well, thought, well, there's got to be a way to improve this. So in the early 90s, she hired and spent her life's fortune and borrowed a bunch of money from her family in order to hire multiple engineers who were familiar with scanning technology as well as electronic data analysis, and created an electronic check processing system that would plug into electronic ATM machines and other financial data accumulation in order to match data from banks to end users to facilitate the check cashing process. She ended up building a couple prototypes, created videos, and if you ever see these videos, they're kind of the classic early 90s videos with a very large ATM machine and some bad late 80s music. And again, another example of somebody who was probably not the best business person. So she went on a roadshow with these 80s music, 1990s ATM machine things, and attempted to promote her technology to the largest banks in the United States. She got a number of opportunities to present to the banks, and they all ignored her. Unfortunately, a couple years later, in the late 1990s, the largest ATM manufacturing company, Diebold, and a number of large banks said, that technology sounds really good, but let's just infringe it and let's not talk to Robin. Robin was subsequently left with a lawsuit, so she hired a cheap attorney, which was all she could afford. She filed a case against a large bank. They immediately filed a number of actions against her and essentially pounded her into agreeing to settle the case and drop all charges. That's when she met Eric Spangenberg, who began to fund her with better attorneys, and she started winning cases and actually settling against banks. Now, that's kind of a short opportunity. If you want more details on those two cases, you can read through the 50 or 60 pages of my law review article, but that kind of summarizes the background of what these two entities had. What's interesting is that both of these inventors, Tom Woolston of Merck Exchange and Robin Gustin of Capital Security Systems, viewed their technology as completely innovative and completely the basis for their business, and that the only way that they could get their business started was by having the patent. In order to own the property rights, in order to raise capital for their companies, and then in order to present that in a public manner. Unfortunately for them, it did not work initially, and they ended up in litigation lawsuits. The tough part about this story is that when we talk about all of the problems associated with patent trolls, what we can't look at is the licensing and the licensing that's actually going on with patents. So when we compare all of the accusations against patent trolls, and the number that's generally thrown around is that patent trolls cost the innovation economy $29 billion a year, the number that we ignore are the licensing dollars spent in order to facilitate the commercialization of technology. And that's because license agreements are generally private and confidential and can't be disclosed, and there's no way to gather data on them. But what we do know, from at least looking at the case studies, is that based on these two inventors, and I spent a lot of time interviewing these two people and discussing their companies and everything, is that modern inventors see obtaining a patent covering their invention as the fundamental motivation to invent and the only protection possible to protect their business. And the litigation that these two companies, Merck Exchange and Capital Security Systems, brought forth is that patent assertion entities are actually enforcing patent rights against companies that they originally sought business partnership relationships from. And from having practiced in patent litigation for a number of years, and from looking at numerous other cases as part of my scholarship, it seems like this is true for a majority. Now, more empirical work needs to be done to make a broad claim, but the case study emphasis here is that for at least two companies that were labeled as some of the worst trolls in America or represented by one of the worst troll litigators in America, this is absolutely true. These are companies that have ripped off the small inventor in order to take advantage of the litigation system and to take advantage of the opportunity that they have. And what's true about both of these companies as well is that patent assertion entities represent the original inventors and the patent applicants who initially intended to build and manage their own companies. A couple more points based off of the details that arose during the case studies is that patent assertion entities assert inventions which were revolutionary at the time. So a big rub that's certainly part of my article is that an electronic ATM machine doesn't seem all that innovative, and eBay's Buy It Now system seems like something we've had for a long time. But if we look at the late 80s and the early 90s, and somebody who was one of the first people familiar with the internet or when ATM machines actually did look like a 1980s 8-track machine, these were innovative processes. These were things that cost hundreds of thousands of dollars to design and build, and they were things that are certainly off patent now. They've expired, or they would certainly be obvious if they were filed, but they were certainly innovative at the time. Moving on and looking at some broader pictures of trolls in history, and this is something that I really like to look at because if we're talking about late night TV and John Oliver, and or the White House discussion at the State of the Union, we generally think of trolls as being a new problem that we haven't experienced before. But if we look at the historical basis for what a patent troll is, an individual, again, that owns patent rights but does not actually practice those rights, instead asserts those rights, we see numbers of examples of this in history. And a couple points that I like to bring out that are usually interesting to my students is that in the year 1883, in one district, one federal district, the Southern District of New York, there were over 1,000 patent infringement lawsuits filed, and they were against end users, individual farmers, for infringing a single patent on well drilling technology by a company that had actually purchased that patent. And it was over 75% of the civil cases that were filed in that district in one year alone. So certainly a patent troll that we would know it today, but back in the early 1880s, in a district court in New York. Another great example of this is Charles Goodyear. So everybody knows Goodyear Rubber Company. Well, Goodyear Rubber Company actually did not begin by making tires. Their growth was associated with the patents surrounding the vulcanized rubber technology. Charles Goodyear was not in the automotive business. He was in the design and manufacturing business. And the first use for vulcanized rubber, does anybody know? First use was for rubber, it wasn't anything automotive. It was actually tooth filling material. So this was in a day where if you had a tooth problem, you either pulled the tooth or George Washington had wooden teeth, supposedly. Charles Goodyear's vulcanized rubber was fundamentally used by dentists in order to fill holes from fillings. Well, Goodyear, not manufacturing things, was in the business of licensing the technology in order to allow dentists around the country to use it. Well, dentists in the 1800s, as potentially with dentists today, were a very ornery group of people who didn't like to be told what to do. So Goodyear had failure associated with the licensing of vulcanized rubber to dentists, and dentists began infringing. Well, in the middle 1800s, Goodyear made his money by suing individual dentists around the country, and actually had a team of patent business lawyers finding dentists and suing them. Well, unfortunately for Goodyear's patent team, his business manager and chief lawyer, one day, I believe it was the evening before a large case being held in the district court in San Francisco, was gunned down by an irate dentist who did not want to be sued for his use of vulcanized rum. So certainly a patent troll problem that was very passionate, at least to the dental community. Finally, going with the theme that great patentees, great inventors like Thomas Edison are bad business people, and the specialization that is necessary within today's intellectual property system, Edison is regarded as probably the greatest inventor of the United States, was actually a horrible businessman. And the quote that I have up there from Henry Ford, Edison was the world's greatest inventor and the world's worst businessman. And if we think about the growth that Edison had in technology and his businesses, there were numerous examples of failed businesses and amazing examples of all the creations and inventions that came out of his Menlo Park laboratories. And it truly was the specialization associated with inventing and obtaining patents and then licensing those patents that made Edison famous and made Edison a rich man. And it was the assertion of those patent rights against others who would infringe, and Edison's strength in being able to litigate that encouraged those licensing ventures. So Edison, again, another example of a pure patent troll. Truly, his business came from the licensing, not the practicing of the invention. So in short, there's truly no historical basis within the patent system to require inventors to commercialize products. And with that, I have a couple more notes, but I'll hand things off to Professor Janis, and then maybe we can open the floor for discussion afterwards.
Yep, sounds great. I'll just stop from here and be quick about it. I do have some slides. I might put those up in a second, but let me see how much time we have. I want to make sure we've got time for questions. So great presentation. So if I have time, I'll tell you a little story about the well drilling patent holder, which I've studied in a lot of depth. But first, let me ask you this. So are you grumpy? Are you grumpy about the weather? Are you grumpy about the election, the economy, law school, up until last night the Cubs? Now we're okay. I can tell you who to blame. Patent trolls. Everything you can think of, it's the fault of patent trolls. Now, if you have worked like we have in patent policy circles for the last few years, that has been our world. That is, everything is blamed on patent trolls. So you got a legislative proposal you want to make? Call it an anti-patent troll legislation. You got a litigation argument you want to, you know, produce? Spin it so that it's a patent anti-patent troll thing. So I'll give you a couple of examples. So I was in D.C. last week debating the Apple versus Samsung design patent case that's in front of the Supreme Court. And one of the arguments was Apple should lose its $400 million in damages for design patent infringement, because if Apple wins, it will embolden a new group of design patent trolls. All right, you can find that argument all over the briefs. So that's one example. The week before that, as was mentioned, the FTC issued a lengthy 100-and-some-odd page report on patent assertion entities, kind of sounding the alarm over a particular type of patent troll that they referred to as litigation trolls or litigation PAEs, and offered kind of a timid, I thought, set of legislative proposals, including, among other things, the requirement that district court judges stay patent litigation against end consumers in favor of litigation among manufacturers. I can get back into that in a second. But, you know, a set of legislative proposals that they offered that were mostly about the litigation process in patent litigation. So, you know, maybe you would say to yourself, in that kind of an environment, what we really need is some objectivity. Good, hard look at the numbers empirical studies on the patent troll phenomenon. Well, that's been tried and continues, all right? So there have to have been a couple of dozen, would you say? A couple of dozen important major studies over the last 5 years or so on the empirics of the patent troll phenomenon. Here's where they brought us. Total stalemate. So you have a famous study that says, for example, that patent troll litigation costs U.S. businesses $29 billion a year. You have an equally famous study that says, total crap. Nothing near that number. You got a famous study that says that most patent litigations that are filed now are filed by patent trolls. You got an equally famous study that says, no, they're not. And actually, those filings made on behalf of patent trolls are actually going down, all right? And et cetera, et cetera. It's like the presidential debates. I mean, at the end, it's just stalemate, all right? And this is why the project that Ryan is talking about is actually a really important project, because what he's doing is saying, wait a minute, there's another methodology here. Let's do a detailed case study. Maybe it helps in some respects to get us past some of the problems that have plagued these empirical studies. One major problem is how you define what a patent troll is, as a lot of the discussion reflected. And it also allows you to examine some of the nuances that lie behind some of these generic labels. So the project, which the theme of which I would say is it's complicated, right? It's more complicated than you think. This patent troll idea is really, really a useful project. Now, of course, doing a case study has its own methodological limitations too. So for one thing, it is dangerous to extrapolate from case studies to generalized conclusions that I think you probably mentioned. And if I had one criticism of the project, it would be, you know, of course we have to recognize that we have to be cautious about any kind of extrapolation of that sort. And I think there I would probably just be reinforcing statements that you already made in the paper itself about being cautious. Another limitation is that in some of these scenarios, it's sort of hard to predict the end of the story when you're living through the story. And that's where historical analysis can be really useful. And you saw a little bit of it. Let me go back to it and tell you an historical story about a scurrilous patent holder and about a populist outcry that resulted from it that was a big deal right here in rural southern Indiana, among other places. So here's my story I wanted to tell you. Nelson Green was an unbalanced individual who was always in court. This guy had been briefly a Union Army officer, but he was court-martialed for shooting one of his own men. He litigated against that, all right, challenged that. He got kicked out of his church. He sued his church, all right, and et cetera, and et cetera, et cetera, all right? Now, in the early 1870s, he patented a method for constructing a water well by driving a rod into the ground and inserting a sleeve, and you get water. And in some parts of the country, notably here, that works really well, really well. All right? Now, Nelson Green, this unbalanced individual, and his driven well patent are talked about today as the canonical example of the patent troll. And the argument is that his story totally conforms with the stereotype. And there's lots of different ways to articulate the stereotype. I'll just point out three things. Guy comes in with a low-quality patent, asserts this patent abusively for nuisance value, often against end users, and this patent is the foundation of a business model that is undesirable because it doesn't involve innovation, it doesn't involve manufacturing anything, it just involves enforcing this patent for its nuisance value, all right? That's the stereotype. And a lot of modern scholars accept that stereotype and just are constantly invoking this as a standard troll story. Here's why it's more complicated, just like you heard about Merck Exchange and capital systems. So, and I don't think I'll get up and show my slides because I'm too lazy to get up and do that. So, first, the quality of the patent that was asserted here, all right? So, if you look at it, sure, it looks kind of bogus, but the validity of this patent was challenged in multiple courts, at least a dozen reported decisions. No, that's okay, it's fine. At least a dozen reported decisions, three trips up to the Supreme Court and back down, and it survived all of those challenges for a while. All right? So, boy, it's you know, that doesn't look to me necessarily on its face like a low-quality patent. You know, that's all. That's kind of it's complicated, right? Litigation tactics, number two. Yes, this patent was massively asserted. This was the patent that was, you know, asserted in 1,000 lawsuits in the Southern District of New York, and that's a tiny fraction of all the assertions, all right? Often it was asserted against end-user farmers for nuisance value. There would be ads in papers, in local papers around here. I've got newspaper things that will say things like, come to the courthouse, drop off your $35 if you're drilling any wells or if you're, you know, driving a rod into the ground to get water on your farm because you owe these people. Not a lot of pre-filing investigation there of infringement exactly, right? I mean, it's just these ads come in and drop off your money. Now, that looks like the worst sort of low-life patent assertion behavior, but the problem is this guy's got a method patent. It's not very clear at all that there was any other practical way to enforce rights in this patent other than to go around and assert it against end users. So, you know, is it sleazy? Yes, in certain ways. But what are we really saying there? Are we saying, well, this guy shouldn't have that patent anyway because it's we should render it effectively unenforceable? It's complicated. Lastly, the business model. So this guy, Nelson Green, would say things like, you know, my business is enforcing my patent. And that's not very helpful, all right? But the fact is that he was not the plaintiff in most of these cases. As was typical at the time, he assigned rights out in this patent all over the country, limited geographically. That was the efficient way to enforce patent rights in a day when it was hard to get around in the country. And the main recipient of one of these assignments was a guy named William Andrews, and that guy was a legitimate inventor, entrepreneur, ran a company that made pumps, other well drilling equipment, so you can kind of see why maybe he'd be interested in that patent. And he's a producing entity. So I find that really interesting because I'm not even sure how he would be labeled for purposes of an empirical study. There would be a debate that you'd have to have about whether this really was a patent assertion entity or something else. And so that just gives you a glimpse of the kind of ambiguities that you run into in these stories, and hopefully that reinforces really what you said about some of the modern case studies that you've done. So let me end with this. So the advantage of looking at history is that you can see how the story ends, all right? How did this story end? Well, lots of interesting things here. First of all, there was a public uprising. So there were meetings all over southern Indiana and elsewhere. There were, you know, headlines that said indignation meeting over patent, driven well patent, stuff like that. Serious stuff, all right? That's number one. Number two, there's a lot of proposed legislation. And if you look at the legislation that was proposed at the time, it includes a lot of the elements of the bills that are now in front of Congress today, including, for example, limitations on patentee's ability to sue end users. I shouldn't say same exact thing, close to the same thing, all right? And lastly, all of this pressure to address this enormous problem, and it was perceived in some quarters as an enormous problem, very quickly dissipated. And that's another story that I won't go into in any depth. It's a great story, though. But it's because the driven well patent ultimately was invalidated. Not over third-party prior art. It was invalidated on a public use bar based on the inventor's own activities. So more of a technicality, if you will. And all of that happened because there was a small-town lawyer who took this case all the way up to the Supreme Court, kept fighting, ultimately got this patent invalidated, and suddenly all this outcry went away. So what do you conclude from that? Does that just tell you, yes, there was a patent troll problem, and we got lucky that it went away? Does it tell you that in some respects the system actually works? The patent was invalidated through the ordinary course of litigation, took a long time, but it was invalidated ultimately, and the system kind of moved on. I don't know. It's complicated, right? These stories are ambiguous, and that's the message that I'd like to leave you with. In commentary on your work, which I think is very much reinforces that message and is really useful from that standpoint. So that's what I have to say.
Thank you, Professor Janis. So just two additional points following up on that and kind of in conclusion of my talk. So I somewhat skipped over this slide, but this is usually what I emphasize, and I think that your story and critique on my piece is excellent. The original basis for my piece was associated with a large empirical study of patent trolls and the money that was being spent in order to commercialize their patents. So not the troll behavior, but just the commercialization behavior. And I started organizing these entities from another piece of data and began talking with about a dozen or so troll entities and found that due to these licensing agreements, there's no opportunity to share information. So the opportunity to do an empirical study on patent trolls just simply does not exist. And then as a final point, and these are actual quotes from the two inventors of Merck Exchange and Capital Security Systems, and I think that this is what my fundamental concern is with the patent system if we keep throwing around this troll moniker and blaming everything in the world on trolls as you started. So Tom Woolston said that when he was inventing, his original basis for founding his company and for creating his system was without a patent, why would an inventor educate the marketplace and work on an independent idea if somebody else could simply copy the idea? And Robin Gustin, who again invested her life savings and portions of her family's life savings on her system, said, patents are the sole protection to further invention. And it really was the idea of having an enforceable property right that they could use as they saw fit as the basis for the invention, which is truly getting back to the basis for the patent system and the reason why we have it in the first place.
Well, we want to thank our speakers today for coming out. Thanks.